guests, respected Principal Madam, professors, dear students, warm greeting to all of you. Welcome to special guest lecture on role of lawyers in the administration of justice. I, Dr. Nalita D'Souza, feel extremely privileged to have been given the opportunity to start today's prestigious event. This day couldn't have been more special as our resource person, Honorable Mr. Justice R.C. Chavan, former judge, Bombay High Court, and the author of Yes, My Lord, It Is You in the Mirror, is among us to grace the event. On behalf of the entire college and Marathwada Mitra Mandal, I welcome you, sir, and express our gratitude for accepting the invitation and taking out time of your packed schedule for our college. We really acknowledge your kind gesture. Secondly, huge congratulations on the publication of your book. We sincerely hope that this really does well and touch the core of the masses. I now request Principal Madam to felicitate our guest today with a bouquet of flowers and memento. Let us give a huge applause. May I please call upon Principal Madam to deliver presidential address.
Very good morning, everyone. Honorable Judge R.C. Chavan sir on the dais. Honorable Govind sir, former judge of the High Court, who is amongst us, and we are graced with his presence. Students, teachers of Shankarrao College, it gives me immense pleasure to welcome you to this special guest lecture. Students, you are very fortunate that in the beginning of your career, you got this opportunity to hear R.C. Chavan sir, the vast experience in the legal field. He was in the Pune District Court, then in the High Court, and till March 23, sir was with the Supreme Court of India. So during his tenure, he has gathered variety of experiences which today he will be sharing with you, and I hope you all will get benefited out of it. Sir, briefly, because you are also aware about our founder member, so I will not take much time to introduce our institute, but this law college is established in the year 2003, and the law college is named after late Shri Shankarrao Chavan. He is a founder president of Marathwada Mitra Mandal. So recently we have completed 20 years, but in very short span of time, the law college has tried to achieve whatever good we can achieve in the field of legal education. Many passed out students of this college, they are working in the capacity of judge. Many students, they are working in the Supreme Court and High Court. The law college went for NAC accreditation in the year 2018, and in its first cycle, the law college was accredited with A grade by NAC Bangalore. So we are trying our level best to give quality legal education, and this our pursuit of journey. You are also with us, sir, I expect. And with these words, once again, I welcome you all and I request to continue the further program.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our today's event. It is my great pleasure to introduce our resource person, Justice R.C. Chavan, former judge, Bombay High Court, and author of Yes, My Lord, It's You in the Mirror. His lordship is BSc and has obtained a degree of LLB in First Division from University of Nagpur. He has also obtained a degree of Masters of Law, First Division, securing highest number of marks from Department of Postgraduate, Nagpur University. His lordship has also served for a term as a contributory lecturer in Department of Postgraduate Teaching in the same university. His lordship joined Judicial Service as Civil Judge, Junior Division, and Judicial Magistrate First Class. He was then promoted as Civil Judge in Senior Division and later as an Additional District Judge and Session Judge as well. His Lordship was appointed as Joint Director Judicial Officer Training Institute at Nagpur. He also worked as District and Session Judge and was associated with Maharashtra State Judge Association and served as its President. His Lordship has also worked as a guest faculty at the Institute of Military Law and visited Lal Bahadur Shastri National Academy of Administration for evaluation of performance of IAS professionals. His Lordship has also served as the Additional Registrar and the First Registrar General of Bombay High Court. In addition to this, he was also Vice Chairman of Supreme Court of India E-Committee. Now, may I humbly request His Lordship to please proceed with his valuable words.
So, good morning to all of you. I hope you have been waiting for this for a long time. We have kept waiting here too. So, if you are tired, you can simply tell me that, sir, enough for the day, okay? And remember, because you are supposed to conclude this at 11:30,
yes, sir.
What is the time now?
It's 11.
Yeah. So, half an hour as of right, thereafter, by your grace, okay? I can't stand today because I have got a bad back. So therefore I am sitting and talking to you. In fact, I don't need a mic. My voice is loud enough to reach the last bench. But for the sake of recording, I suppose this mic has to be used. So it's nice to see all of you youngsters entering this first year of law. Just out of your HSC or whatever it is called, third standard. So, my first question to you is, why have you chosen this profession, chosen this course, law?
So, I got thinking about law from my father's friend who is working in the HDFC bank in Mumbai. And I like his work, so I thought I could also join.
It's good that you like this and therefore you joined. Anyone who is here because parents desired? All of you are here on your own volition. You like to study law, therefore you are here, right? Yes. This is one profession which touches every aspect of life. Right from conception to the post-death disposal of bodies. Everything. Therefore, you see the life in all angles when you join law. And you get to entertain yourself as you practice or as you preside over a court. If you enjoy your work, then you like it. So therefore, every day a new drama unfolds before you. A litigant who comes to you with a problem, it's always new. Because every life is new. Every person is different. Do you perceive yourself as a part of a herd, a group, first year law students of Shankarrao Law College? No, isn't it? You want to distinguish yourself, right? You want to be known as yourself, not as a part of the group, correct? That is what law does. Law puts people in slots, and also enables people to distinguish themselves from that slot. Therefore, if you take interest, you will enjoy this profession like anything. You will enjoy the study also like anything. Every case you are taught will unfold a story of life. It's not just law. It's not just dry, black and white. There are different shades in life. You will see all the shapes in life as you study. Therefore, please enjoy your study. Don't bother about what the examiner wants or how many marks you score. The question is, how far you enjoy your studies. If you enjoy your studies, you have done it. So today, I am supposed to be speaking on the role of lawyers in administration of justice. How many of you really want to take up lawyering? Great. Why? Why?
Because
your dad is
a lawyer.
And therefore you want to become a lawyer. Right? So you must have seen your dad working his practice, clients coming to him.
Yeah.
Yes. So therefore, what does your dad tell you about role of a lawyer in the court in administration of justice? What is the role of a lawyer in administration of justice?
She is supposed to respect the judge.
Be loud. Lawyers are supposed to be loud. You have to make yourself audible to the bench.
The court is supposed to respect the law.
Yeah, this is first thing. That whenever you address a judge, you have to stand up. Judges sit, lawyers stand. Recently, I had a session with Chief Justice Garit, retired as CJI. So, we were together for almost whole of the day. And he took the first session on maybe it may not relate to you, but affirmative action. Professors will take over what affirmative action in course of time. First session lasted about 2.5 hours. Then we had a lunch break. Again, 2.5 hours we addressed on affirmative action. And all the while he was standing, did not take a sip of water. I asked him, how come for 5 hours you have been addressing all of us standing? He said, judge, you have been judge for all your life, 40 years. So you will sit and listen to people. I have been a lawyer for most of my life except the last 8 years. So I can stand and address. So first you said, stand and address. Okay. Dig out here. Now you said that the role of lawyer is to defend his client. How many of you agree that role of lawyer is defending the client? Hesitant hands are there. Either you are on this side or that side. Guilty or not guilty. Make up your mind, what is there? Nothing is going to happen. This is not a court where a verdict is to be pronounced. So you decide what is the role of a lawyer to defend your client. So nobody is with you. Why do you feel that it is the role of the lawyer to defend the client? Again, see, this is the trouble. When you open your mouth for the first time in a class, then you are the target of the audience.
Your client's side properly in front of the judge for the guilty or not guilty.
Thank you. So, see, the moment you start thinking about something, when you say something and start thinking about that, or before speaking out, you think about something, you have a change of mind. Isn't it? You refine your words. That is what lawyering is about. You refine your words, rephrase them and put them across to the judge. As she said, it is not defending the lawyer, putting up the case, defending the client, putting up the client's sales, client's side before the judge. Lawyers are called as officers of the court. You know that? Why are they officers of the court? What is their role as officers of court? See, if you perceive yourself as spokesperson of your client, you are not assisting the court. Lawyers are supposed to be assisting the court, assisting the judge in coming to right conclusions. And why do they put up the case of their client forcefully? Why? Not because the client has begged them to speak loudly. They put up the case of client forcefully in order that both sides, judge is able to see both sides of the coin, all the possibilities. They unfold all the possibilities to enable the judge to make the right choice. If you duck, of course, the judge will not see one side. So judge should be able to see both the sides, everything, and then decide what is right or wrong. Now, should you prejudge a matter when a client comes to you and tells you that, well, I shot somebody? What do you do? I shot somebody and now save me. You take it back to if you are shot, you have to go to hell. Right? What do you do? When he says that I shot somebody, I have come to you to save me. Confused? Suppose tomorrow a client comes to me and tells you, I have shot somebody. What is your duty? Yes, please. Very good. As a law-abiding citizen, you should be telling police what you know. No. Why not? As a law-abiding citizen, you have come to know that somebody has been shot. So what is your duty? Am I putting 50-year questions to first-year students? See, these are questions about life. These are not questions about law. So therefore, answer according to your 18-year-old, I suppose. Your 18-year-old experience in life. See, if you don't raise your hands, I will be taking up two speech, right? So decide. And I am not likely to choose the first benchers. Because enemies, after all, lots of things ask benchmen. So make up your mind whether you are going to answer or not. Okay. See, if you take the Gandhian model, then you have to wind up your practice. Gandhi had to wind up his practice. He came as barrister from England to Africa. But then he found it to be unethical for him to be doing certain things. His weapon was satyagraha. Now here, even if somebody tells you that he has or she has shot someone, it doesn't mean that the person concerned should not be defended. Because there are various aspects of shooting. Shooting is just one act. Shooting is preceded by something. Shooting is succeeded by something. You have to know everything and then decide how you are going to deal with the guy, how you are going to put his case in the best possible manner before the judge. What has actually happened is for the judge to decide, not for you to decide. What has actually happened may not be known even to the person who comes to you and tells you that I am shot. See, Hindi movies, somebody pulls a trigger and somebody falls down. But the bullet which has hit the person has come from somewhere else. So there are so many possibilities, so many things can happen. You have to examine all these facilities in order to ensure that justice is done. This is something which you can do without even going further in your studies of law right now. This was Professor Michael Sandel. Yes, Edmund, back to. What did I say just now?
There's a professor. You named a professor.
What is his name? Okay. His name is Michael Sandel, Professor Michael Sandel. Doesn't teach law. See, two things you must remember in life. First is rapt attention. Whatever you are doing, whether you are in a classroom, on a street, in a court, anywhere, but rapt attention. You should be fully absorbing what is happening around you. And then remembering things, not allowing yourself to forget. Because lawyering is all about remembering things, recalling things then properly. So Michael Sandel has put up several videos on the YouTube. Okay, you can see them. It is about what is the right thing to do. What is the right thing to do? So when you see those videos, you find dilemmas in life. How many of you have read, heard of Ramayana or Mahabharata? Everyone, great. So there are several dilemmas in Ramayana and Mahabharata. Everything is questionable. There is a serial called Dharmakshetra. If you have time, you can watch that. See, because studying law is a thing which is not so important. Studying life is important. You should know what is life. And then you can understand law. Law becomes easy to follow if you know life. So, what is the right thing to do? Are dilemmas in Ramayana and Mahabharata? Just examine them for your own sake. Was Rama justified in asking his brother to cut the nose and ears of Shurpanakha? Then, if as a fallout, Ravana carried away Sita, was he wrong? Etc. So, therefore, think of dilemmas in life, think of how why people behave in a particular fashion. That will help you to become good lawyers. And what is projected as a fact before you by your client may not really be a fact. Because what you see is not necessarily what you perceive. You see this. What is this? Bottle of water. How do you know this? Because you have been told, trained, taught that this is a bottle of water, isn't it? You see a red object, red round object. Because you have been taught that it is an apple, you know that it is an apple, right? So perception depends on your past experience and training. What you see is not necessarily what you perceive. I suppose your library has that book. If it is not there in the library, I recommend to Dr. Deshmukh getting from the library. There is one author called Dwight McCarthy. His book is Psychoanalysis and Law. He has put a story in that book. That story I'll tell. A man had a quarrel with his wife and he decided to kill his wife. He took a Tommy. What is Tommy? Okay. An iron bar. And then he gave a blow on the head, he was killed. In order to show that it was an outsider's job, he kept the latch of the door open, outer door, and went to the bed. They had a maid servant staying in one of the servant rooms in the house. So maid servant got up in the morning as usual and went to the room of her mistress. Wake her up, taking tea and all that. She saw the mistress lying dead in a pool of blood. And she started shouting, get out, call the neighbors, etc. Everyone came. Police were calling. And the statement of maid was recorded. She said that as usual, I got up, I went out. Opened the latch of the front door, went out, and then after eating it, I went to pick up my mistress. That statement was believed by the court, naturally. Why did she say that she opened the latch of the door? Because every day that was what she was doing. So because of her habit, though she had not opened the latch that day, she said that she had opened the latch. It was a guy. But that guy nailed the husband. And whatever precaution he had taken to show that it was an outsider's job, fell flat. Went in for a life. So therefore, what you perceive depends on your past experiences, past learning. What you consider to be right or wrong also depends on what you have been taught, that this is right, this is wrong. When the Chief Justice of India talks about transgenders or same-sex unions, this is hurt, no? What is it? Because this is what we have been taught, this is what we have learned, this is what we have seen. That there is something else in my life, do we know? No. Therefore, if you are to enter the profession, you have to keep your mind open to all sorts of possibilities. How many of you have studied drawing in your classrooms and school days? Why? Great, great. Model drawing you have done? Model drawing? Yes. How is model drawing done? In the classroom, an object is given. So you sit around the object, you draw it. So everyone is looking at the object from a different angle, isn't it? And you draw it from a different angle. Heard the story about the elephant, seven blind men of India describing an elephant? They touch and. So therefore, it depends on from which side. At what point of time you are looking at the object? So suppose a flower pot is kept for in a drawing class, and in the first hour you have drawn the flowers. The teacher does not change the flower pot, and in the evening she comes there and she also has to draw the same thing. So the flowers are by then dried up. So she draws dried up flowers from the same flower pot. You draw fresh thoughts. Time. So therefore, all these things you have to bear in mind. How many of you are giants? Should not be asking a question about religion, but I am asking. Giants? Great. Only one. But then, acknowledging that you are a giant results in the next question. You have heard of Adekantavad or Syadvad? No. See, Jains had a big spread in India and ruled over a big part of India. Right from the south of Ganges to north of Kaveri. Okay? This Anekantavad or Syadvad, about which Shankaracharya, Adi Shankaracharya had a great dispute and debate. What does it say? It is this that is what Shankaracharya wanted to say. Yahi hai, it is only this. And what do Jains say? Jain philosophy says, Yahi hai. This is also there. Anekantavad and Ekantavad, that is the difference. Okay. So there are, this is also possible, that is also possible. So you are open to possibilities. You are open to seeing the things from different angles. And that is what makes you a good lawyer. That is what enables you to examine things from all angles. Otherwise, a hasty decision made on the impulse of your mind, may lead you to a disaster. Now, can you in your lives, all of you come from very well to do families? I suppose your fees are some lakhs of rupees. Still, all of you are coming from very good families. What is life for a person in Islam, can you imagine that? No. are the compulsions there? Can you imagine them? No. Can you expect a lawyer or a judge to give all those rights? No, you can't. Adi Shankara went in the body of a female to understand what a female feels like. Okay. But we are not Adi Shankara. No? So, we have to take that experience from literature. So, read as much as you can. There is one more book which I recommend. If it is not there, please get it. It is State versus Justice. Author's name I don't remember now. Young man will say, what is this? You just now told that you should remember everything. And you don't remember the name of author. Okay. I confess that at the age of 71, I am entitled to forget something. This is because your ability to search has also been tested. I told you State versus Justice. What could it be? State versus, can you imagine what is State versus Justice? Versus, you know, no? England versus Australia. Opposite. So State versus Justice, what could it be? Yeah, please.
I am assuming that State versus Justice would mean that some decision would be passed which would not be fair to a state or something.
It's a story about a person called Justice. E.J. Justice. Okay. So this Justice was charged with murder. And the American story, of course, novel. So, he had a defense attorney. You know, in America they call attorneys, district attorney and defense attorney. So, there was a defense attorney. This is the problem with big principle. Administrative responsibility are required. So there is a defense attorney who is quarrelsome, cantankerous. For every motion he will oppose. You know what are motions? In court, motions are made. No? That is, motion is a request to the court. So every motion he will oppose. That was his reputation. But in this case of State versus Justice, the defense attorney was unusually quiet. Did not ask, did not oppose any motion, just kept quiet, smiled, kept quiet. It was not like Dara Sahib Kapoor. Anybody know Amaravati? Is that the area? No. There was a contemporary of Dara Sahib Kapoor, B.G. Kapoor. He was an eminent lawyer. This is, of course, an anecdote, maybe false. So Kapoor was once conducting defense for the murder trial. He also unusually kept quiet in the end. And the judge sentenced the fellow to death. By hanging. Kapoor kept quiet. And it is said that when the person was to be hanged, no? So Kapoor said that you have not hung him, remove the noose now. Because you have not said, hang till he dies. Okay? That's, of course, just an anecdote story. So this defense attorney in this case was unusually calm. The prosecutor was worried. The prosecutor was worried. Another glass. Okay. I don't want to spoil the entire bottle. So, why is this going to come? finally found out that the area where murder was supposed to have taken place, NASA maps, etc., got the date, time. Then he found that on that day, around that time, photos, good photos.
The president of the United States.
Yes. Photos was going to be in that area, right in that zone. He said that if the president of the United States is passing through any area, NASA, we have very minute maps. They track everything in a square meter, not square kilometer. The maps are so accurate, every meter. So this is thank you. So prosecutor went to the NASA office and said, I want to see all the maps on that day, at that time, from that area. And after scrutinizing those maps, he came to the conclusion that this accused could not have committed the murder, could not have been at that place when the murder was committed. On the next date of hearing, the prosecutor stood up and said to the judge, my Lord, I seek that the charges be dropped. And the defense attorney said, I did not say anything because I believed in your sense of justice. So this is what lawyers are supposed to be doing. Their sense of justice has to be aligned. Not just winning a case. It's about ensuring that justice is done. It's not one mind, judge's mind alone. It's three minds which decide what is the truth and how justice should be done. I have written this book principally because you study law, but you don't study life. In law colleges, life is not taught. You never come to know various incidents which take place in life. There is a story. A young girl had eloped with a boy. And then they were, of course, caught, brought back, etc. The boy was charged. The girl's brother's parents were very strong. So the boy was prosecuted. And the girl had to depose that he had in that we did that, did this, did that, etc. So brothers were present in the court. And after the deposition was almost over, they had gone out. When they went out, the girl said to the judge, that sir, I want to say something to you. Privacy. Personally. So the judge looked at prosecutor. What do you think? The prosecutor looked at the girl. And they said, sir, then you will withdraw to your chamber and you will hear what she has to say. After coming to the chamber, the girl broke down and said, all that I said so far was lie, false. In fact, we had ego together. I love him very much. And I don't want him to be punished. At least do that much. You can't allow me to live with him forever. What should the prosecutor have done? No idea. Just imagine. The prosecutor said that, sir, I close my case. You record this statement of us. I close my case. I don't want to examine any other cases. She called the police officer. She told the judge to deliver a judgment in short the matter to the chamber itself, at least the operating part. And told the police officer to get the boy released from prison with a warrant prepared by the court staff. put the boy and girl on an evening train to the boy's native place, secure. Too much of it. But this is the true story. This is what actually happened. The prosecutor was one Mrs. Reggae. She was, she could do this. She was, there was Professor Reggae, principal of Yuga of his wife. She could do this because she was connected with people, society. She had once been president of Thane Municipal Corporation's education committee and all that. She was in politics also. Therefore, she realized what is life. And then decided that if they come to visit her mind, one good deed I must do, and she united the lovers. Since I am on Mrs. Rick, I will tell you another anecdote of hers. There was one great advocate called Ramakant Gorekar, Antunes advocate, who defended Antunes by his brother. Once in a bail matter, Gorekar was appearing for the accused, for seeking bail. And even before Gorekar could begin, or should Mrs. Reggae do, she said that since he is appearing in this matter, such a senior advocate appearing for getting bail, it's obviously a case of refusing of bail. What should Gorekar have done? Gorekar just smiled and sat down, realizing that yes, it was a difficult case and therefore he was engaged. So therefore all these things also are part of advocacy, a part of life. There are several cases in this book. Please read them whenever you get time. So read them as stories of about life. One Champak Pudha Parthi had picked up a girl, put her in a gunny bag, small girl, and he was carrying her on his back, kidnapping. A person saw this gunny bag making some movement, inside of the gunny bag making some movement, watching, handed over to police, etc. And when Champak Pudha Parthi was demanded to custody, he started behaving as if he does not understand anything. So, the week was open is to refer him to the civil surgeon for evaluation. And a person who is insane can't be put to trial, can't be tried. So, civil surgeon dutifully gave a certificate. He was insane after observing him for 3 days. One vigilant advocate who used to see this Parthi being brought to the court every time and chatting with his relations who used to gather, he said that this baby is not insane, he is just pretending. They requested the judge, sir, please call the civil surgeon. It was unusual in such cases. What is there? Certified to lunatic. Civil surgeon was called. You could take the boys to jail also. Yerwada?
Yes.
Anybody had been to Yerwada?
Not
yet, sir. He had been to Yerwada. When?
Okay,
so he had been to Yerwada. When? Yes. Yes. Okay. So what is the procedure when you enter a prison? You have to sign. And those entries are made in chronological order. So the judge permitted the advocate to put questions to civil surgeon, though the advocate had nothing to do with the case. He asked the civil surgeon, was this fellow brought before you in your civil hospital for examination, or you went there for examination? Now the civil surgeon was a bit disturbed because if the person was brought to the hospital, again the hospital will be entry. He said, I went to the
prism and then examine it. So very well, sir. Please adjust the case. Get the prison registers. Now the civil surgeon was really panicking. He was close to the chief minister and therefore he caused the chief minister to pull strings and told the prison authorities to do something. The superintendent said, I can't do anything because the register is in a chronological order. But there is one line at the top and one line at the bottom. That's all we can do. So civil surgeon showed that he had entered the prison at 5 a.m. in the morning and left at 10 a.m. in the night. The register was produced. It was shown to the civil surgeon. These are your entry signatures. So he spent the whole day in prison. Then he was perspiring profusely and a doctor had to be called to treat the civil surgeon so that it doesn't pass away. He said, I am sorry, I did not examine the matter in. So this is what alert advocates can do. So all these life stories unfold before you when you take a practice of law. Please enjoy your practice and don't be intimidated by the fact that because of DAs, people will not come to courts. DAs are there because we suffer DAs. If we decide, you can cut down the time. You can make things efficient by your own efficiency, your own performance. So, my request to all of you is don't go in for practicing law firms. Sitting in the office of law firms, drafting things which really make no sense because they are, most of it is cut, copy, paste job. Here you see life, vibrant life. Enjoy this, enter litigation, become judges, become prosecutors, become good lawyers. Thank you, ma'am, for giving me this opportunity of talking to this very young crew. So, thank you.